Good morning and welcome to the breakfast meeting. I am Mordecai Mlisa, and I want to again start with saying thank you so much for keeping your eyes on NBS TV. Well, we still have the conversation about the 90 days of oil and mining in Uganda. I always want to remind you about how huge and important this project is. I mean, we are talking about a project that is worth of our gross domestic product, over $16 billion. So you know how important this is. So in all this, as all this is happening, it's going to be developed in an extremely sensitive ecosystem in the Albadai region that has a couple of things to care about. And these include the water bodies, communities, heritage, a game park, and furthermore, it cuts across a couple of districts. So you know how important this is. So in order to do this, or in order to execute this kind of work, it is important for stakeholders in all this to be aligned in this execution or resource exploitation. And that's where the conversation is going to be this wonderful morning. With me in the studio, it is Marion Muyobo, Head of Social Affairs from Total E&P, and James Muhindo, National Coordinator, Civil Society Coalition on Oil and Gas. Good morning, Marion.
Good morning, Mordecai.
Yes. Good morning, James.
Good morning, Mordecai.
Glad to have you.
It's the pleasure is mine to be here.
How do you find this place?
Very cozy, and yeah, I'm really excited to be here.
Oh, have you been here before?
Not here, maybe at the previous studio, but this is really...
State of the art.
Exactly.
Wonderful. And Marion?
Yes.
Have you been here before?
No, I've not been here before. Mm. I may have been here when it was the previous setup.
Okay.
I won't go into that.
Okay.
Yes.
You know, like I've talked about this huge project, one would want to know in doing so, because I've talked about how it cuts across different districts. So one is interested to know about what community engagement and social license to operate about is all about in the context of the Tilenga project.
Right. As an operator, Total E&P Uganda is very deliberate and finds it very important that we undertake engagements with all the individuals and all the groups that are in the project area. In our case, the area is located in the Albertine, specifically in the areas of Bulisa. There is also within the Murchison Falls, that is really Noya district. The communities are outside on the northern side of the Murchison Falls, mostly Acholi land, but also you have in the Bulisa area where we have a massive community. But we also have to consider the locations as we get to these areas. So there are districts, for example, like Hoima, Masindi, Chiriandongo, which we have to pass through. And that's where all our communities are. Now, community engagement is part of stakeholder engagement, which encompasses a massive range of activities that have to be undertaken over the lifetime of the project. I'll talk about the lifetime of the project a little bit later. And all these interactions with the individuals, the persons, the groups, are mostly with those who may be directly impacted, but there are also those who might be indirectly impacted. Like I've said, on the way to these locations, there are communities. So those are the people who may be indirectly impacted. So we don't leave them behind. We undertake stakeholder mapping, and this will end up giving us who the different stakeholders are, and we categorize them. We have the community level, which is mostly at village level. We also then have the next level, for example, sub-county level. Of course, in between you've got parishes, but if I can take the sub-counties, because most people are also familiar with that. And then also at district level. But we are, beyond that, we also have civil society. We have NGOs, not just within the community, but also at national level. So because many of them who are members, for example, of Cisco, that Mr. Muhindo is going to be talking to us about, we end up working with. I also mentioned we are near Murchison Falls, mm-hmm. and we've also got stakeholders there, and those tend to be the tourism stakeholders. So that's the broad mapping of all our stakeholders. And as I said, community is one of the major stakeholders. And we create an engagement plan to which we now follow to make sure we're doing this engagement. Mm. Now, community engagements are therefore undertaken specifically to make sure that the company is ensuring that they are making the process of managing the expectations palatable with the communities. And we do this in order to show our respect to the communities, in order to build the trust that we need to gain from them, and then also maintain, as I mentioned, it's a very long process, and you have to maintain open and constructive relationships with all these stakeholders, especially the ones at the community level, in order to gain the social license to operate. So this brings us to what social license to operate really is about. It is really the way in which legitimacy is attained by the company to register its presence within the community and the core interactions with the community, because the company now then has to become part of the community. Mm. So in doing that, we are aligning and working with these community stakeholders, because they will become also part of our processes. You know, we are going to be recruiting from these communities. We are going to be having to talk to them about using some of the services, sharing services. Some exist, some are yet to come. So there has to be that continuous conversation with most of the stakeholders in the community. So that's what community engagement and social license to operate are about.
Wonderful. She hinted on the social license to operate.
Yes.
Let's focus on that one. Why is it important in as far as extractive projects could be concerned?
Thank you very much, Mordecai. The issue of social license to operate, maybe if I may give a brief background, as Marion just stated, evolves from a place where in the past the mining and oil companies used to rely on the licenses or the contractual relationship they have with governments to go to the areas where they're working and start their operations without necessarily engaging the project affected persons at a higher level, or ensuring that the community where they're operating has a good grasp of what the project is about. In places like Latin America and parts of South Africa, where mining has been going on for many years, it turned out that even when government would give you a license to go and operate a mine, if the community where you're operating do not buy in or agree to work cordially with you, it would end up becoming costing the company much more, where you have to ensure that there is security. There will be days where there will be demonstrations and they block off operations. So it became a very huge cost to companies to operate without getting communities buying in. And that's where the term social license to operate was coined from, where beyond the license you get from the Minister of Energy as an oil company, or the license a mining company gets, they also need to go. If, say, Total is working in Bulisa, they have to make sure that the communities in Bulisa also give them some sort of virtual license, which may not be a document, but it's approval or legitimacy, as Marion called it. So because of this, it has emerged that it's very important for a company to ensure that it has a very cordial relationship with the community where it is working. And the benefits include, first, the convenience that comes with not being disrupted during operations. The second has cost implications on the company's operations. There were reports in the cases I've given where companies would almost spend a quarter of their budget on security, because anytime the community that has not accepted you to operate a project in their area can walk in on you. And there are cases where they kill company staff or they destroy company facilities. So with social license, you're sure that it's the community that is going to say, actually, those projects are benefiting us. No one should touch them. So the social license to operate is as important as the license given by the Minister of Energy or the government, because with or without the social license to operate, you may have a permit from the ministry to operate, but the communities make it impossible for you to operate. So that's why that over time, companies are now putting a lot of time in ensuring that they have a cordial relationship with communities. And also in extreme cases, there are companies that go as far as engaging what they call observer civil society organizations, where from amongst the community or local NGOs that are working in that area, companies co-opt them in the project as they go along so that they keep making sure that the company is sensitive to the social concerns of the community where they're working. So that's how very important social license to operate is. And I think for a project like Tilenga or any mining projects here in Uganda, the most recent was the 2017-2018 chaos in Mubende in the gold mines, where one of the companies that was licensed to extract gold was not having a very cordial relationship with the artisanal and small-scale miners that are from the community. And as a result of that, there was always animosity and the company wouldn't get the best out of its license just because it has not set proper rules or acquired the buy-in from the community around them. So it's really very, very important, if I can put it that way.
Oh, wonderful. Perfect. Let's talk about the stakeholders, you know, in this Tilenga project. You know, every person has heard about the stakeholders. How are the engagements undertaken, and who undertakes them?
These engagements are undertaken by the community liaison officers. So the stakeholders that we have within the vicinity of the operation, some of them are individuals, some of them are communities, and we have to engage them. Right now, the community liaison officers are sourced from the community, because when you're engaging with the community, you have to engage in the local language, and also there are dynamics in the community that have to be known about by the people who live within the vicinity. Now, interestingly, what most people do not know is that we also work with the civil society organizations as part of the engagements, because they are very familiar with some of these stakeholders. And there's instances where the stakeholders, the community stakeholders, go to the CSO, and the CSO is now even the one who calls us. And we come in, we also have our facts, and we are able to have these very open conversations. And this builds a lot of trust, having and seeing that it's not just the company, but it's also the willingness of the civil society organizations to work with these communities on these engagements. So it's primarily, as I've said, the liaison officers on the ground who undertake these engagements.
Wonderful. This project is a big one. I mean, when I was introducing the show, I talked about how it is worth half of our GDP, and it has immense potential to benefit the country and the communities. So one would be interested to know the role of the civil societies. How are they undertaking to ensure this increased awareness within Ugandans about this project?
For us as civil society, we have over and over again continued to say we are the voice of the communities where they are not, in most cases, where they are not able to reach the boardrooms here in Kampala or be able to work in offices for ministries and companies. We have the space to enter into those spaces. So what we do, the information we get when we interact with the government and oil companies and other actors in the sector, we make sure that we relay it to the communities that are directly impacted, but also to Ugandans at large. Now, as for the project, say the Tilenga project, which is a very massive project, we have the oil refinery project, which is also going to be equally massive, and also Kingfisher, which is being operated by CNOOC. All those projects combined together actually may surpass the GDP. So what happened initially, there was a lot of expectations for so much benefit and in a very short time. So as civil society, actually we are partly, some even blame civil society for peddling that agenda, but eventually we discovered the need to manage expectations. So what we do is to tell the communities, to relay to the general public, the information that is actually based on facts, so that people don't have outrageous expectations of the oil and gas sector. Because this is one of the reasons that make the relationship between companies and communities go so aware. They expect so much in a very short time, and the moment these expectations are not being met, then there is chaos. So we come in as civil society to ensure that we share information that will help to manage those expectations. The other is capacity building for communities, local governments, and even amongst us as civil society, where like the oil and gas sector is a very new sector here in Uganda, barely 20 years, so everyone is still learning at work. So we've tried to take time to ensure that as many Ugandans understand what the sector is about, and this we do through media engagements, dialogues at national level and at district level, and I'm sure even here on NBS, every 3 months we have talk shows where we discuss in detail certain aspects of the sector. This is all intended to share as much information as we can. But also, we try to be the voice of the community. As I said, there is a power asymmetry between communities and the companies and government on one hand. Communities are vulnerable, and government has, of course, the power of the law, and companies have also the power of both in knowledge, experience, and also the capital they are investing. So we always try to help the communities that may not have as loud a voice, and that's why, as Marion stated, we have incidents where community members are concerned. Instead of going to companies or government who should be responding to their concerns, they come to us because they believe we are the ones that may get audience, but also we are the ones that may put their point across better. So we try as much as possible to ensure that we are the voice of these members, sections of society that may not be able to express exactly what their concern is to a project that is half the GDP of the country. You imagine you have only an acre of land to lose, and there is a project that is going to invest half the GDP of the country standing in your way. What would, on a balance of probabilities, government would say, you lose your acre and the project goes ahead. But we try to say, much as his is an acre that is worth 3 or 5 million, he has to be given what is rightfully theirs before the project that is massive goes ahead. Mm-hmm. So that's what we've come into play, and it's not a very easy place to be, where sometimes you're speaking truth to power or sometimes seeming to be stalling processes, but we go ahead as civil society and stand and make sure that government and companies know what is exactly the truth about these community engagements.
And I'm sure you have found some people who say, no, I do not want. Whether you talk about how it is half our GDP, I don't want that project on my land.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's what is happening even currently, where we have some people saying, we don't care what the country is going to benefit. I need this before the project goes ahead. And it's a lot of pulling of ropes.
Oh, it is indeed, yes. A very huge one. As an operator, what would be some of the challenges that you are facing in all this?
We have a number of challenges, but primarily the way we look at it is because Total has got a code of conduct, And there are three major aspects within this code of conduct, and one of them is in relation to dialogue with stakeholders. So for whatever challenges there are, we have to make sure that we are available. So some of these challenges are related to the fact that we say we want to definitely have these meetings, but many of the stakeholders are not able to get to these meetings for different reasons. We have vulnerable people, people with disabilities, for example. We have women who have got to work during certain times mm-hmm. of the day. We have even men, you know, they have to go fishing, for example. So the timing is one of the challenges, but we have to create specific groups. For example, we have women-only engagements within the community because of the challenges of having to, the times of the day that they have to do different things. Even for the fishermen, we have to create specific engagements for them. And then also, yes, logistics, as I've mentioned, also includes sometimes getting to the venues. So we have to create engagements where it is easy for them to get to. The other challenges are in respect to the thematic areas. Land acquisition, for example, is one of them. James has just talked about people feeling that they definitely need to be given what is worth their while. So getting to the point of ensuring that a person understands what exactly they're entitled to is normally a process, but we endear ourselves to make sure that we get to the point that an individual clearly is very comfortable with their entitlement. There are other issues related to environmental concerns around upcoming activities. People are concerned about pollution. People are concerned about the influx that is coming. Are they going to have enough land to till? Are they going to have enough land for their families to expand if other people are coming in? So we have done a number of studies, and we have a number of mitigation plans within the environmental social management plan. This is a section of the environmental social impact assessment, also known as the ESIA, and we have created social safeguards. We are partnering with many stakeholders, including the communities, to see how to safeguard against some of these risks to abate the challenges which are in forthcoming.
Let's talk about engagements. How does civil society work with operators? I'm talking about government, the communities. When it comes to stakeholders' engagements, I know you have hinted on it, mm-hmm. but if you could go broadly.
What we've been doing is, especially in the oil and gas sector, we fortunately have, I won't call it very formal, but an arrangement where every 3 months we meet and share notes on what is happening in the sector, where the companies present to us what they're working on, and we also share some of the concerns that are emerging from the community. But also in terms of our engagement, we go ahead to have strategic meetings where every time an issue emerges, we write and request for an engagement with the concerned company or the concerned ministry or department and agency. And that's why we have had several engagements with the Ministry of Lands over, say, compensation rates, where we go to a district and it turns out the district sent in their compensation rates. But for over 9 months, the Ministry of Lands, which is supposed to approve them, has not. And as a result of that, the communities are being compensated at rates that are not approved. So we engage the relevant department. We also do this through our research, where every year we go and monitor the impacts oil developments are having on the environment and on people and the livelihoods of those directly impacted. So when we produce these reports, we share findings and come up with recommendations which are always acted upon. And those are some of the ways through which we engage with operators and communities on different issues from time to time. Mm.
Marion, we've talked about a couple of activities, and the question now to that person that is watching is when will these, you know, all the activities we've talked about be undertaken in the Ugandan project?
Okay, so right now we are in a phase before I would call the pre-development phase. And what's going on right now? We have to acquire the land where all the infrastructure is going to be put. We need land where an industrial area is going to be established. In that industrial area, you've got a central processing facility. This central processing facility will have a lot of infrastructure which is related to the oil that will be brought from different wells. Their well pads are located, of course, outside the industrial area in different locations. And there's also a feeder pipeline, so there's land needed for that. A feeder pipeline runs from Bulisa up to Kabale in Hoima. There's connecting flow lines, the water abstraction. So all that land has to be acquired. And as you know, land transaction, all of us have bought land. It's not a very quick process, and in this particular case, it's actually a much longer process. So that is what is going on right now. We are in the process of acquiring the land. There's studies that have to be done. There's a resettlement action plan that has been undertaken, actually a series of them. And then we have to resettle. We've done resettlement for one of the locations. We are going to do more resettlement in the next couple of, within a year. And it's within that year that these people, we also have to make sure that their livelihoods are restored because they have moved. Now, once that land is available, there's civil works which has to be undertaken. So this pre-development phase is where you're going to have an enabling infrastructure contractor come in and undertake the civil works within the acquired land. Once that phase is done, the next phase after, of course, the final investment decision is made, is that we have to now start bringing in all the equipment that is to be installed in order for us to get to a point where we announce first oil, which will be many years. So during that development phase, you're going to have rigs being brought in. That's why you're seeing UNRWA, you know, so doing oil roads and all these kind of things. So the rigs are going to be coming in. They'll have to be installed. There's a feeder pipeline, as I mentioned, from Bulisa to Kabale in Hoima, which has to be put in place. In that period also, the East African crude oil pipeline section of Uganda will also have to be done. So that development phase, this country, even this region, will have never gone through what is actually going to be coming in. So there's all that infrastructure that will be coming in during the development phase. Once all that is in place and first oil is announced and we go into production, production will not be less than 20 years, as you've been reading and people have been mentioning in the past as part of this 90 days. The production phase, actually things will kind of go quiet, I would say. But we shall have to continue community engagement because we have to maintain this social license to operate. It is in this period that, yes, there will be a lot of community issues. We do not want to be like, you know, countries where there have been issues in the community. So that's why we have to maintain our community presence in order to maintain that social license to operate. As and when the production starts getting to a point that requires us to start decommissioning, it will take different phases. It will happen over different phases. And that decommissioning phase also, we shall also see again a ramp up of activity because people have to come in, infrastructure has to be put in place to make sure that we are leaving the place hopefully even better than we found it in terms of restoration of many of these sites.
Okay.
So it's a very long period of time.
We first use our time, and yes. I will start with you in just the blink of an eye, a few seconds, to give you a concluding remark.
First, I just wanted to, in a second, to say that all those activities or interventions that Marion just explained are going to result into massive capital investment where a lot of money will be coming into the country to help in putting in place those infrastructure. So my one of my parting shots would be to call upon Ugandans to position themselves to see that what Petroleum Authority has said is an estimated $15 to $20 billion dollar investment in within 3 years is a lot of money that if Ugandans can position themselves to work with the companies and government, we can benefit immensely. The other thing is that I would like to communicate to oil and mining companies that natural resources, oil, gas, and gold, and other things belong to Uganda. And so in the course of developing these for commercial benefit, we need to know that at the center of this benefit should be the Ugandans so that we don't leave Ugandans worse than we found them, because it doesn't help for you to come and run an oil project in a district, and after 20 or 30 years, the district is worse than it was before the project came. And those are cases we don't want to have here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
In a few seconds, what is that last word you want to say?
Total is committed to open lines of communication and will continue to share information with all stakeholders, receive their feedback, provide and share the actions in order to ensure we maintain this social license to operate.
Thank you. James and Marion, thank you so much for paying a visit to us. There is a common saying that when America coughs, the whole world sneezes. They're counting ballots in the USA. Are you for Trump or Biden?
For Biden.
And
definitely Biden.
Let's wait and we shall be knowing who is going to be winning. Well, my name is Mordecai Mlisa, and I thank you so much for keeping your eyes on NBS. Good morning.